Good morning.
Morning.
How lovely to see you today on this beautiful August morning. Somebody was praying for rain, I guess, so we got it. I guess the farmers were praying for rain. Aren't we blessed to be in Canada, to be safe and secure? We have so much to be thankful for today. Irene right now is, I think, somewhere on the Blue Danube, cruising the rivers of Europe. Got an email yesterday from her from Cologne, Germany. And so she's having a good time over there, she and her daughter, Lorelyn. So let's continue to pray for Irene. And we're very thankful this morning to have our dear brother, Gary, who's very valiantly and wonderfully filling in for us today. And Gary and I were speaking about this earlier, and Gary mentioned to me that, you know what, Irene does a lot that we just sort of take for granted. So we're thankful for her and very thankful for Gary. We have some announcements. The treasure and craft sale will be this coming week at Normal, and that's going to be from Wednesday to Saturday. So please support that if you can. The proceeds all go to a very, very worthy cause, supporting a school, a Christian school in the Dominican Republic. And the Hendersons, of course, are very much involved with that ministry, so it's worthwhile, and I highly recommend it. A special announcement, we announced last week, and we're announcing it today again. There's going to be a congregational meeting, a special meeting, next Sunday, immediately following the service, and we're going to be talking about a proposed Spanish ministry. Now, this past week, Irene sent you out an email with something that I wrote up about it. Did you all get that? Okay, if you didn't, we will give you a hard copy of it, so you'll be able to be better informed as we talk about that next week. Something that I'm very excited about, and I know some others are as well. I hope it's something that we can support. We have been able to, in the past, as you well know, long before I ever arrived here, and that was 10 years ago, by the way, this church was very much involved in outreach to the community, so that people, even though they didn't attend the Union Church, they knew very much that we were here, and that we cared about this community in which we live. Now, because of circumstances beyond our control, we haven't been able to do those things that we have done in the past. This could be another initiative for us to let the community know that we care not only about those who live here all year round, but we care very much about those fellows that work in the fields and gather in the crops so that we can eat. And so, we want to be able to minister to our Mexican friends. Certainly we can't do it. Does anybody here speak Spanish? I thought no. So we need to have some...
Un poquito.
A little bit. Okay, there you go. But a really tiny little bit, right, John? All I can say is hasta la vista, vaya con Dios, but other than that, I'm not very good. Gracias. And that's about it. I'm a little bit better in French, but Spanish, forget it. Anyway, we're going to be talking about that next week, and hopefully we can do something to just give us a little injection of excitement in our church, knowing that we can do something that will be very pleasing to God, our Savior. So that's next Sunday, immediately following the morning service. Now, do we have any other announcements? I'll be mentioning some folks for prayer when we get to the prayer stage, but is there any other announcements that I forgot? No? I don't? Good. That's wonderful. So let's begin our service of worship and praise. So glad that you're here today. Together, as we say, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. Let's stand together, take your blue book, or just look at the words on the screen. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. pray this morning, and we've been asked to remember in prayer Audrey, Marion and Gord's daughter in Ottawa, who's suffering with some severe pain, and the doctors are centering in on what the problem probably is or could be. Marion and Gord, like Gord as well, are heading off to Ottawa this week to be there to help Audrey and to look after the kids, the grandkids, which I'm sure is a horrible chore. Oh, what a horrible thing to be asked to do, to look after your grandchildren. When they turn 16 and they no longer think and worship you, then you might change your mind a bit. Right now, though, it's good when they're little. So please do pray for Marion and Gord as they travel, and please pray for Audrey and Russell as well, and their whole family, the Cat family. Please remember, as was mentioned last week, Elaine's grandson-in-law, thank you, who is suffering from multiple sclerosis. And if any of you are familiar with it, it is a wicked, dreadful, insidious, slow-moving, and relentless disease. We have experienced it in our own family. My brother's daughter has had it since 1989. No, she was married in 89. She was diagnosed with MS 2 years later, and she's had it ever since. So we're very familiar with it, and our hearts go up to Adam and his family. So continue, please, to pray for him. You know, when people are continually ill, chronically ill, sometimes we forget. I mean, are we praying as much for Dave Thompson as we were in the past? And the answer probably is no. We ought to, you know, knock ourselves on the side of the head, because we need to keep praying for Dave. It's a tough life that he's living now, but let's continue to pray that God will raise him up. Obviously, we need to pray for the Christie family as well. Peter has been in the hospice now for over 3 months, which is phenomenal. That someone would last that long in a place where, let's face it, where you go to die. But Peter is still very much with us. So pray for Peter. Pray for Marshall and for the whole family through this terrible ordeal that they have been going through and is continuing. Our lives, you know, it's easy for us to put the blinders on, isn't it? And not to think about others who are so close to us and who are precious to the Lord and need to be precious to us, the church family as well. And then, of course, we need to continue to pray for this sad world in which we live with so much strife. But you know, in the midst of all of this, and we'll be talking about this again this morning, we need to praise God, indeed, from whom all of our blessings do flow. And so, let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we can call you our Father. This puts us into a whole new realm of thinking, because you are not just a God, a spirit, an unknown entity who billions of years ago brought this universe into existence, and then at some point brought mankind into existence on this little planet Earth. You're not just some entity who created and then deserted. In Christ, you became one of us. And Jesus taught us that you are our Father, that we are a family, that God loves families, and we were created to be in union with each other, in communion with the one who created us. So thank you, Heavenly Father, that we are part of your family, the family of God. We praise you for your grace, for your mercy toward us. We thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us never, ever to forget what he's done for us and what he has promised to do for us in the future. We thank you that because of him, we know we have the assurance of life beyond this life. So we thank you, our Father. Lord, we do pray for those who are in authority over us and with election. person of your choice will be brought into the position of power. And Lord, that whoever that person is, that they will be made aware that you are real and that they are accountable to you as well as to those who vote. Lord, we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine, the incredible suffering that is going on there. We pray, Lord, that you'll bring an end to that conflict and bring true and lasting peace. We know that would be a miracle from our point of view, but Lord, in your time, in your will, we know that you know what you're doing, Lord, but we confess that we don't understand. So, Lord, we pray you'll give us understanding and give us compassion and give us a heart to pray for those who are in danger, in peril today. And Lord, we pray today for Christians all over the world, things that never make the news, but we know that there are Christians who every day in Africa, in Sudan, are being enslaved. And we find that hard to believe in the 21st century that that could happen. And we know, Lord, it to be a fact, but we are unaware of it, we forget it. Lord, it's so easy for us today to say, I'm a Christian. It's so easy to do that because the persecution that we get is just nothing compared to real persecution. So, Lord, we pray that you'll help us prepare our hearts to serve you. We read in your word that those who would live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. So, Lord, we ask you to make us godly, knowing very well what that may entail for us. But, Lord, we want to serve you. We want to make a difference in this world. We want to stand up and be counted during these dark times. We want to stand firm and faithful to you. And we give you thanks that we are enabled to do that through the power of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. And so, Father, now, as your family, together, we pray the wonderful prayer Jesus taught his first family. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Well, turn around, stand up, stretch, whatever, but say hi to everybody and be thankful for God's people. And together, let us welcome each other as we sing. For you I pray, God's peace, that indeed I is readings for this morning.
Our first reading, our responsive psalm, is Psalm 146, and it's on page 660 in your pew Bibles. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul.
I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live.
Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save.
With their spirit and hearts, they return to the ground. On that very day, their hands come to nothing.
Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
The maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord remains faithful forever.
He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free.
The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the way of the wicked.
The Lord reigns forever, your God, who is right for all generations.
Praise the Lord. Our sermon text for this morning comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 to 13, and it's on page 470 in your pew Bibles. After this, the Moabites and the Amorites, with some Midianites, came to wage war on Jehoshaphat. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is, En Gedi." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, "O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, 'If calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us.' But now, here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt. So they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance? O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." All the men of Judah, with their wives and children and little ones, stood there before the Lord. This endeth the reading.
Thank you, Mary. Well done. as his mother was making supper. She asked him to go into the pantry and get her a can of tomato soup, my favorite kind. But the little boy didn't want to go alone. He said, "It's dark in there, and I'm scared." So she asked him again, and as she was in the middle of cooking, she needed the soup. But he wouldn't go. Finally, she said, "Johnny, it's okay. Jesus will be in there with you." So little Johnny walked hesitantly to the door, and he opened it. He peeked inside, saw it was dark, and there was no way he was going to go in there. But all at once, he had an idea. So he opened the door and just poked his head in, and he said, "Jesus, if you're in there, would you hand me a can of tomato soup?" So that's a cute little story. But you know what? There's a lot of truth in it. Remember, in fact, Jesus is always with us. And we forget that sometimes, don't we? And we get all scared and frustrated and frantic. But he is with us. God, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, is with us and will be in us if we invite him. We can't see him. It's a spirit. He's a spirit, but very much real. And you know, how do you get in touch? Well, I seem to recall that it's an old gospel song. I'm always thinking of old gospel songs. And you know why I keep thinking of old gospel songs? Because I don't know any of the new ones. Because they don't have, the lyrics don't please me, so I don't bother memorizing them. This one says, "Prayer is the key to heaven, and faith unlocks the door." That's good, isn't it? Prayer is the key to heaven, and faith unlocks the door. So, you know, I hope, given all the circumstances we've been going through over a long time now, I hope that there's one thing that we have all learned, and that is to pray a lot more than we ever used to do. And I think you find that as you, the more you pray, the more you grow in faith and in trust. The last two Sundays, we've been thinking about two profound and important things. First of all, drawing near to God. Drawing near to God, intentionally getting as close to God as we possibly can. Now, most people don't do that. Most people try to stay as far away from God as they can, right? Because if you get too close, it can get a little bit scary, as it was for poor little Johnny in the dark closet. What will God ask me to do? What will he want me to do? What will he force me to do? So we tend to stay away, because if you get too close to God and God wants us to do his thing, maybe we won't be able to keep doing our own thing. But anyway, we talked about what happens if you really do, intentionally, with a pure heart, draw near to God. Secondly, last week we talked about, okay, having done that, what does God expect of us once we do draw near to him? What does he want us to do? Does he, what we normally do is present him with a checklist, right? Here's my checklist, God. These are the things I want you to do. This is how I want you to do it. This is when I want you to do it. Okay? Are you all set? Okay, amen. That's not what God wants us to do. We found out that God wants us to praise him. To praise him before we ask him for anything. Today we're going to think, to look at something that's far easier for us to think about, because we don't have to imagine, no one here in this room need to imagine what it feels like to be overwhelmed with fear. Have you ever been overwhelmed with fear at some point in your life? How about more than once? Some people live in a state of constant fear. It's so tragic. Fear, anxiety, grief. Some people carry grief with them their whole lives. Like, my heart goes out to dear, usually European women who wear black the rest of their life when their husband passes. passes away. Like, can't you get on with your life? And the answer is no, they can't. I'm not judging anybody. It's just so sad to see. But all of us, we're all in the same boat. All of us have had feelings such as that at some time or another. Fear, anxiety, grief, you name it, we've all been there. These are the things that every human being experiences, and as I said, not just once, but many times in our lifetime. You know, right now, just let your mind go back, each of you. Let your mind go back to some of those times in your life when you were really frightened to death, frightened out of your mind. Can you think of an occasion? All of you probably can. We've all been there. The sermon this morning, the text tells the story of what happened long, long ago when a king heard that his nation was in imminent danger. There was an invading army on the border. They were about to be wiped out. The army was far greater in numbers than any army that they could pose against them. The name of the king, you already heard, was Jehoshaphat. Does that sound familiar to you? When I was a kid, we had an expression. We used to say, jump in Jehoshaphat. Did you ever do that? Yeah. Jump in Jehoshaphat! And we also used to say, holy cow! Right? But you can't say holy cow nowadays because you might offend some Hindu. We have next door neighbors that wouldn't be offended at all, but, you know. Politically correct, we have to watch everything we say today. George Orwell wrote a book called 1984, remember? And back then, he wrote it in the 30s, I think, and he prophesied very accurately what it would be like. You know, think, speak, when they would actually be looking at what you're thinking, let alone what you're speaking. And where language wouldn't mean anything anymore, when words wouldn't mean anything anymore. And boy, was he right. It's sort of a scary situation in which we're living today, and it seems like every day something new happens to underline the state in which we're living, this state of unrest and uncertainty and fear. And you know, today, we talk about offending other people, and I know I've said this before, I'm going to say it again. You know, why is it okay to use Jesus as a swear word? Have you ever thought, why is it okay? And not just once, but all the time, without even thinking about it, just casually, people use Jesus or Christ or a combination, whatever, as a swear word. Do you know why people continue to do it? Because true Christians forgive their enemies. That's why. You just say one word against a certain prophet that we all know, hear about a lot in our culture now. You just say that one word, and you can be charged with blasphemy, and in some countries, put to death. Yeah, over here, Jesus is used as a swear word. But you know what? Do you know why that's okay? Because it proves how strong we are. Right? It proves that what we say we believe is borne out in our actions. Forgive those who persecute you. Forgive your neighbor. Forgive offenses made against you. Forgive. Forgive. Be gracious. We hear all around us today people demanding justice. I don't know about you. I don't want justice. Do you know what I want? I want mercy.
Amen.
I want mercy. Because I know what I'm guilty of or have been guilty of in the past. I don't want justice. It's terrifying if I were to have to pay for the things that I have done. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
We thank God for mercy. We thank God for grace. Justice, no. Forgiveness, forgiven. And that admonition follows precisely in the verses following, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For if you do not forgive your neighbor, neither will you be forgiven." We ought to include that in the prayer to remind ourselves. Anyway, we are strong the more we're like Jesus. That makes perfect sense, doesn't it? The Apostle Paul wrote this to the Colossian church. He said, "God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Jesus, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." Peace cost Jesus everything. What kind of a price are we willing to pay for peace? Well, that's the end, I think, of a very good tangent. I got that off of my chest. Getting back to the story of King Jehoshaphat. Remember the story. When Jehoshaphat heard that there was an enemy about to attack, here's what he did. First, it says, he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. You heard that. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat led the people in prayer. And it was a prayer and praise. A prayer that was full of praise and faith as well. First, the praise part. He said, "Are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you." That's praise. And then faith. He said, wanted to say, "If calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment, or plague, or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name, and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us." It's a prayer of faith. Praise followed by faith, and it must be in that order. Now, Jehoshaphat, he was the king. The country was facing a terrifying invading army. The people were depending on him to do something. As one who was attempted, leadership does not come naturally to me. I would rather be a follower than a leader. No one leads unless someone's following. And if someone wants to follow a leader, they're looking for the leader to show them something, right? To do something, propose something, do something. Jehoshaphat was the king. He had no choice. And so the people were depending on him to do something, and he did. Do you know what he did? Now, picture this. The invading armies at the border, crossing the border, ready to attack. He has his army waiting, a smaller army, but it's waiting. What did he do? Do you know what he did? He sent out the choir. You look confused. Let me explain. The sermon text that Marion read for us was from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, but I purposely ended the reading at verse 13. Let me pick up the story again. I'm not going to read it. Let me just tell you the story. Starting in verse 14, we read about a man called Jehaziel. He had a long and distinguished family history, and so was no doubt a man whom the people listened to. We get that from the text. But the reason King Jehoshaphat listened to what Jehaziel had to say was not because of the man's place in society, his family, his status. The reason Jehoshaphat listened to him, as the text says, the Spirit of the Lord came on him. Now, what does that mean? It's very simple. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon someone, when someone is, in other words, is filled with the Holy Spirit, it means that that person is guided by God. Other things may happen too, but the most important thing is that person is guided by God. They're aware of His presence in them, and speaking through Him. That was Jehaziel. Jehoshaphat was wise enough to recognize that this was a man who was filled with the Spirit of God, who was standing there in front of him. And this was a man to be listened to. This man stood out from the crowd, a godly, truly godly man. And Jehoshaphat recognized. So this is what Jehaziel said to the king and to the people. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army. Get this now. For the battle is not yours, but God's. I love that, don't you? Don't be afraid. It's God's fight, it's not yours. That's a statement of faith. Then Jehaziel went on from that, and he told the king to wait till the next day, and he gave him a detailed battle plan. Now, it's an amazing plan. And I'm not going to tell you what it was. I want you to look it up for yourself later. Promise me, you'll go home and you'll read at least verses 16 and 17. Can you imagine that? Read the whole story. You'll find it incredibly fascinating. Anyway, you'll also see that he also said later on, he said, do not be afraid, don't be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. And then it says, right then and there, Jehoshaphat bowed down with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem fell down and worshiped before the Lord and praised the Lord with a very loud voice. Think about this. What would happen right now if all of you got out of your seat or stayed in your seat and got down on your knees or got in the aisle and fell flat on your face and started praising the Lord? And somebody walked in the front door. What would they think? Yeah, right. They're all nuts. And anyone who didn't go along with what the others were doing must have thought the same thing. They're all crazy. But they weren't doing it to put on a show. They were doing it because they were truly touched by God. Not only were they truly touched by God, they were scared of their minds. They're going to be wiped out by an invading army. What were they going to do? The king said, praise the Lord. Get down on your faces and praise the Lord. Well, so what happens? The next day comes, the day of the battle, and we read, as they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful. And then, what happened next? Well, Jehoshaphat's army went out to fight the enemy, right? No. Wrong. Instead, this is what Jehoshaphat did, and I already told you. Let me read it. Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, give thanks to the Lord. For his love endures forever. I wonder what the tune was. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. It's incredible, isn't it? Think about that. I wonder what his army thought. You know, those trained soldiers. I wonder what they thought when they heard the king, you know, send out the choir ahead of them. Sure, they probably thought, is he nuts? Sending out the choir ahead of us? They're going to get slaughtered. Not only that, I wonder how the choir members felt. all of those of you who are or have been choir members, would you like to lead the fight? Irene's not here. I think I hear Irene saying no way. What a terrifying thought. Hold on, Jehoshaphat. You want us to do what? Maybe that's where that expression, jumping Jehoshaphat, came from. know, let me just give you an introduction. You know what happens? The invading army started fighting each other. They did. And the army of the Lord just stood back and with their mouths wide open. Wow. Read the details. Aren't you intrigued? Don't you want to know the details what happened? You gotta read the story. It's a great story. So, verse 30 says, and the kingdom of Jehoshaphat was at peace, for his God had given him rest on every side. Wow. So what does this story really, what does this story, this ancient story, true story, what does this mean for us today? Well, let me ask you a question. Do you want peace in your life? Do you want rest in your life? You'd be crazy if you didn't. Is anyone here crazy? I don't think so. We all want peace. We all want rest. So in order to get that peace and the rest that we all need and want, what do we do? Well, there are at least two lessons we can learn from this story. And I'll just talk about two of the lessons. First, and most important, is that when we are faced, when you are faced with an incredible and even frightening challenge, before you do anything else, this is what God wants you and expects you to do. You can tell me, what does God want you to do? The first thing, praise Him. That doesn't even make sense. I'm going to praise you that my daughter's sick. I'm going to praise you that the friends are dying. I'm going to praise you that I've lost my job. I'm going to praise you that I don't have any money to pay the bills. I'm going to praise you that I'm dying of an incurable disease. I'm going to praise you. And God says, yes. Yes. Not because God has an ego that needs to be fed. But as I said over the last couple of weeks, when we praise God, that is when we truly get in touch with Him. Because you can't praise someone who's not there. And so when you praise God, you are aware that He's there. You are in touch with Him. See how important that is. God does not need our praise. We need to praise Him. And He knows it in order to get in touch. The other reason I want you to know this morning is that when people obey God, first, when they obey Him by giving Him their praise, what happened? Simply, then and only then they were given the faith to trust Him. Simple, huh? You can't have faith and trust in someone you don't know. You can't have faith and trust with someone from whom you are estranged by distance. You can't have faith and trust in someone and you have built up walls and barriers and you haven't been on speaking terms. You can't do it. And so when calamities happen and you call out, God, where are you? And there's no answer, well, there's no answer because there's been no connection. Get it? It's so simple. Even I can understand it. I think a child can understand it. Think about this. I'm thinking of my son, Kevin. When Kevin was a tiny little boy, we lived in Rock Forest, Quebec, and we had a French split house. So you went in the front door, and you had two choices, go up some stairs or down some stairs to the basement, just a tiny little landing, just a small house. And so every day when I came home from work, and back then I was pastoring the church, every day when I came home, I would come in the front door, little Kevin would come running along, and he'd get to the top of the stairs, and without it stopping, he'd jump, Daddy! And he'd jump into the air. And, you know, it's quite a, you know, 6 or 7 stairs, whatever it was, I forget. At quite a distance, he'd jump, I'd catch him. It was fun, it was a game we had. As he got older, He got bigger. He's 6'5" now, by the way. He got bigger and heavier, but the game didn't end. He kept running and jumping, and I prayed I could catch him without falling over. One day he was a power player, I remember. One day he was a power player. And it was dark when I got home. It was the winter. Got home. Went over and opened the front door. And I heard Kevin, not running this time, but called up my name, "Daddy, are you there?" I said, "Yeah, of course I'm here." And he said, "Oh, okay." And then I knew what he was thinking. I said, "Kev, you can jump. I'll catch you. I was too, but Daddy, I can't see you. Jump! I'll catch you." And the little character did. He was still a little bit. And I caught him. A wonderful experience. You know, I hadn't thought about that in 40 years. It's true now.
Did I ever tell you that before?
If I had, I know you'd remember. But it's a true story. Why did he jump into the dark? Because he knew I was there. You see? There was a relationship. There was a confidence that had been built up, a closeness, an intimacy that had existed before. And then when things got dark, even though he hesitated, it was hard for him, he knew I'd catch him. You see? That's the difference. That's why we have to praise God, get close to God, establish the connection, and then when tough times come, then we can have faith in Him, we can trust Him, and then we can have rest, and we can have peace. Well, the sermon was entitled today, Hymns of Powerful Praise. I would love to have been there to hear that choir sing that day. Wow. And next week, we're going to hear some more about some more hymns of powerful praise. And I trust that God will bless you this coming week, help you to get close, and to have faith, and to trust in the one who loves you. Amen. Now receive our offerings. God bless you as you give.
Praise God. Thank you that you allow us to give back. And
Lord, this morning as we see the offering plates, the new offering plates, we thank you that, they've been provided for us, and we took the old ones for granted, but this morning, Lord, we want to take a minute and pray for those people who broke into our church last month and who stole the offering plates and a few other things as well. Lord, we ask you to forgive them. We ask you to confront them. And we ask, Lord, that you will bring them to faith in Christ. And if we can in any way be a part of that, Lord, we would like to be able to do that, to be able to have those people stand in front of us and say, we forgive you and welcome to our family. It's a good lesson for us, Lord, a practical one in giving and receiving and forgiving. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as our closing hymn today, number 332 in the Blue Book, a wonderful, grand old hymn of the faith. Boy, we call it old, and I think it just came to into our hymnology around 1964. It was even like yesterday to me. Anyway, let's sing together. How great thou art!
Thank you.
through us to everyone we meet this week. Amen.